Headline Audio presents History, written and read by Miles Jupp. Part 1, May 1998. Chapter 1. It's just one afternoon, Clive.
Is it, though? It always ends up being a whole day.
Yes, but a fun day.
But will it be fun?
Clive, if you approach it as a fun day, then it will be a fun day. Ian Dixon was 50 years of age, tall and whippet-thin, with thick grey hair and a noticeable lack of concern for the views of others. He was childless, often single, and had taught art and design at the same unremarkable private school for a quarter of a century. Why it was felt by the powers that be that this would make him a suitable person to take on the role of careers officer was something that was never adequately explained. But nevertheless, one afternoon a week he would sit behind the desk in the school's small careers office and languidly describe to the teenagers sitting opposite him the narrow courses that their lives would follow and the paths of least resistance that would take them there. If his views were ever challenged, Dixon would simply look back at them with a serene expression and say, "It is, of course, all entirely up to you." It was this very same facial expression, almost as much as the man's envious build, that was currently infuriating Clive Hapgood. Clive was only 38 years old, but a stone heavier than he'd been a decade ago, and had hair that, though still just about more brown than it was grey, was somehow neither as thick nor as curly as it used to be. Of the many things that gnawed away at Clive like Highland ticks, the most pressing was how to stop this smirking, disingenuous fool from persuading him to play for the staff cricket team this Sunday. "Ian, can I think about it? I'd have to make a few calls. I'm not sure I'm free. I'll put you down as a probable. I really don't think Helen would like it.
Tell her to come. Bring the children. It'll be fun."
Clive and Helen had been married for 12 years, and they had two daughters, Sarah, 11, and Katie, 8. They lived in a mid-terrace house not far from his place of work, and too many of his history students walked past on their way to and from school for him to ever feel truly at ease. Once a group of 15-year-olds walked by as he was dropping a clutch of empty wine bottles into the rubbish bin next to his front step, and they laughed at him. Another time he had heard boys laughing and joking outside his front door, and when he went outside he found that his scrappy, narrow front garden had been decorated with pages from a pornographic magazine. Those too went into the rubbish bin. He thought he recognised the miscreants' voices, but what was the point of pursuing the matter? It would only be more fuss. "Ian, I'm not sure that a Sunday is really the best day for my family. It's our one chance to be together."
"Well, can't you be together at the cricket? We won't start until 12. You've most of the morning free to wash the car or read the papers. You could grab breakfast somewhere."
"I grab breakfast in my own kitchen, and I don't spend Sundays washing my car, Ian. And I barely have time to read the Sunday papers, let alone turn out for your...
It is, of course, entirely up to you."
The staff room was filling up now. Perhaps Ian could turn his attentions elsewhere and leave Clive to drink coffee. The jug sitting on the hot plate under the filter machine was already half empty, he saw, and there was a queue forming.
"Anyway," said Ian, "you look like you're anxious to get your morning coffee, Clive. You're down as a probable."
Clive gave what he hoped was a non-committal smile and set off in the direction of the coffee machine and his head of department, Robert Ike, who was at the back of the queue. Ike's latest crime was to clamp down on the amount of use his department members made of the photocopier. Clive was about to tap him on the shoulder and discuss the matter when someone at the front of the queue gave an almighty howl.
"Oh, Jesus Christ, bloody hell!"
The queue broke up and Clive could see the figure of Wally Davis, bent double and sucking on two of his fingers while jumping up and down. Those who had been in the queue, Ike among them, took this opportunity to push past and get to the coffee, while Wally, his face reddening, clamped his eyes shut and tilted back his head. Clive put a hand on Wally's shoulder.
"Okay, Wally?" he asked.
"Jesus, that was hot!"
"Let's get you away."
Clive helped Wally up to his full height of 5'3" and walked him over to a wooden armchair in the corner. Wally, perhaps to compensate for his unimposing height, always wore jackets made from an incredibly heavy tweed that added considerably to his girth and restricted his movements, with the result that he struggled to sit back all the way into the chair, and instead had to perch on its front edge in the manner of a self-conscious Humpty Dumpty. The jackets also meant that Wally was always too hot, whatever the weather, and permanently marked with perspiration. He wiped at his forehead with a cuff and looked sadly around.
"Why do people have to jostle like that? Of course I'm going to spill hot coffee on myself if people are rubbing up against me.
I've always thought someone might get seriously hurt. It would be me, wouldn't it? The first two fingers of Wally's right hand were dark red and mottled with white lumps, and appeared to be swelling even as Clive watched. He would need medical attention, although the school nurse's brusque bedside manner would only break Wally's morale further. In any case, the low urgency with which she offered medical help hardly qualified her as an emergency service. Wally himself seemed less concerned about the physical aspects of his injury than the behaviour of his colleagues.
It's unseemly, don't you think?
Yes, said Clive. But then it's always been like this, hasn't it?
Doesn't make it right.
Why don't I get something for your hand? Clive shuffled over to the sink under which he vaguely recalled once seeing some Savlon and plasters. He got down on all fours to open up the cupboard, but as he did so, several bottles of cleaning fluid tumbled out, bringing with them a profusion of browning J-cloths and an assortment of parched washing-up sponges. Removing an aging, perished plunger, he saw a red box behind the U-bend that could be a first aid kit, and so also took out two old Jif bottles and a wooden box of shoe polish. The U-bend was quite tight against the back of the cupboard, and so Clive had to reach as far as he could just to lay his fingers on the box. Then, to get sufficient purchase on it, he had to lower his shoulders and roll onto his side so that he could hook his arm around the back. He could now get a decent grip on the box, but was unable to pull it towards him, so he tried instead to punch the box through the gap to collect it from the other side. His third punch saw some success, at which point he heard a voice say, "Everything all right, Clive? This all seems rather desperate." The remark made by Frampton's headmaster was intended to be jovial. Clive paused to glance over his shoulder and saw that he was looking up at Julian Crouch's pinstriped trousers. His moustached but otherwise Roman-looking face was the best part of 6 feet away.
"Hello, headmaster," said Clive.
"You're looking as if you're trying to burrow your way out. Things can't be that bad, can they?" Clive chuckled politely and then continued trying to push the first aid box through.
"I'm just trying to get a first aid kit. Wally Davis has burnt himself," he explained as the box finally came loose. He poked his arm around to the other side and then stood up, holding the first aid box triumphantly.
"Well done, Clive. You've left yourself with rather a lot of tidying up to do, of course."
Clive surveyed the cupboard's useless contents, now arranged at his feet. There was a bar of green fairy soap that must have been older than he was. Clearly it all belonged in a bin, but Clive, like everyone else before him, was just going to shove it all back in and shut the doors.
"Everything else going smoothly, Clive?"
"Well, the lower sixth are
excitable?"
"Tiring." The headmaster gave Clive an admonishing look. Like everything that the headmaster said or did, he intended this to be taken humorously, though it was meant entirely literally.
"Tiring? For a young man like you, you're supposed to be dynamic. You seem happy enough rolling about on the floor of the staff room."
The head laughed, and Clive did his best to join in, despite always finding their interactions as bothersome as they were chilling. The headmaster's laughter ended as abruptly as it had begun, and the possessor of the school's most perennially straight back strode off towards the coffee machine. Clive shoved the various crumbling cleaning materials back in the cupboard, then opened the box and found it empty.
"No plasters or anything, I'm afraid, but I thought it might help if you lowered your fingers into this."
Clive passed a glass of water to Wally and sat in the next armchair along. He was never quite sure if the chairs were coffee-coloured by design or through years of hot spills. Wally had tried to force his fist into the glass, but his hands and fingers, much like the rest of him, were stubby and didn't fit in. He gave up and instead sipped the tepid water.
"Do you think someone might make another pot of coffee?" Wally asked.
"Robert looks like he's having a go."
Robert Ike had fitted a new filter into the machine and was now very slowly and deliberately filling it in accordance with the handwritten instructions affixed to the side. He then took great care as he transferred the old filter towards the bin to ensure that no coffee seeped onto his crisply ironed short-sleeved shirt. He always wore a short-sleeved shirt, something Helen had once told Clive she found annoying. Clive was more irritated by the way Ike whistled and the irksome waft of his scented moisturiser. Wally gave a little lopsided smile.
"He's another one."
"Robert?"
"Never speaks to me. Worse than the head."
"I'd happily never have to speak to either of them. Still, at least Ike knows something about teaching, which is more than you can say about Crouch."
"He can't have taught a lesson for years, can he? He's basically an administrator.
He's a sort of meter and greeter, really. Likes the formal wear, handing out prizes at the end of the year. I saw him showing some parents around in the quad yesterday. He was being unbelievably suave.
He pointed me out to them and said, "Young Clive there is scurrying off to teach the historians of tomorrow. Sick-making." "I hate suave people," said Wally sadly as he looked down at his blistering fingers. "Oh, God."
"Why don't I get us both a coffee?" said Clive. But just as he stood up, Crouch began to strike the side of his cup with a teaspoon. Everyone fell silent as the headmaster strode into the middle of the room. Clive lowered himself back onto the arm of his chair.
"Thank you, everyone. I don't want to keep you from your morning coffees for long. There are only a couple of things I have to say."
As he spoke, he turned expansively from side to side so as to take in all corners of the room and to connect with his entire audience of around 50 or so.
"The first thing I wish to do is to introduce you all to Flora Wilson. Where are you, Flora?"
A tall, slim woman with dark hair took a step forward from a group huddled by the notice boards and gave a cheery, confident wave.
Early 40s, Clive reckoned.
"Thank you, Flora. There she is. Miss Wilson is here for a few weeks to observe us for the last..." He searched for a suitable word for a moment, and having found it, made full use of its plosive possibilities. "For the last portion of this summer term, before joining the Frampton staff permanently in the autumn as part of our excellent history department."
Wally flashed a quizzical look, and Clive shot back a look of complete innocence. Who was leaving?
"I'm sure that you can all be relied upon to be as charming and helpful as ever, but please do all you can to make her feel as welcome as is humanly possible."
As each plosive struck Clive's inner ears with full force, he was reminded of last night's drinking. 4 glasses of red wine. Not a heavy session, but ill-disciplined for a Wednesday night. Portion, permanently, please, possible. Still 2 left in the chamber. "If you see her wandering the corridors looking lost, do set her on the right path."
As the last word of Crouch's most recent utterance ricocheted around the room, Clive wondered why nobody had told him that there was going to be a new member of staff in his department.
"The other thing I have to do is remind you that our staff cricket side, so capably and enthusiastically run by Mr. Dixon, have a match this Sunday against a..." "Who is it against again, Mr. Dixon?"
"Wilbrook," said Ian smoothly.
"And are they an intimidating outfit?"
"A walk in the park," said Ian.
The headmaster found this expression priceless. Clive, meanwhile, slid backwards on the arm of the chair to try and get more comfortable, but felt the back of his trousers snag on something.
"A walk in the park!"
Bang. The chamber was now empty. "Our team are, however, a few short. I myself am unable to help, as my wife and I are out of the country this weekend at a wedding. But it would be wonderful if a few more of you could volunteer your sporting services to Mr. Dixon. I'm sure that it would be quite untoward of us to enlist Miss Wilson so early in her Frampton career, though she's doubtless an absolute tearaway fast bowler."
Crouch laughed so loudly at his own remark that Clive was sure he felt some wax in his ear dislodge. "Mr. Hapgood has apparently keenly offered his services only minutes ago, so please don't be shy about following his excellent example."
He beamed at Clive, and then performed a little bow to the assembled staff to indicate that his morning oration was over.
"Playing cricket on your day off?" said Wally, as the hubbub resumed.
"Hopefully not. I'm going to try to persuade some other people to play so that I can pull out."
Clive made to stand, but found that he had not yet managed to work his trousers free of whatever it was that they had snagged on. He leant forward, but could feel the fabric pulling, and so attempted instead to manoeuvre his posterior gently about in the hope of releasing it.
"Have you got an itch, Mr. Hapgood? You are a victim of events this morning, aren't you?"
The headmaster turned to Flora Wilson.
"I thought perhaps you ought to meet Clive Hapgood. Clive is a fellow historian. You'll be working side by side, I imagine."
"Robert Ike's told me all about you," said Flora as she offered her hand. "Pleased to meet you."
Clive, still perched, took her hand and shook it warmly. He tried to stand as he did so, but the negotiations between his trousers and the chair's arm were yet to reach a successful conclusion.
"I would stand," said Clive, "but I've got a bit of an issue with my..."
"You're far too young for back trouble, Mr. Hapgood," beamed the headmaster.
"It's a problem with my trousers, actually."
"Ah," said the headmaster, "marvellous."
He held out his hands like a priest over the gifts, gave an assuming smile, and turned on his heel. Wally stood up and proffered his own hand, remembered too late that it was burnt, and so simpered when it was taken.
"I'm Wally," he winced. "Wally Davis, welcome to Frampton, Miss Wilson."
"Yes, it's actually Mrs. Wilson."
Oh, well, in that case, congratulations, said Wally. Not for long. I'm in the process of getting a divorce.
Commiserations, then.
Clive had spent the last few exchanges struggling to get free, and now felt just a few crucial millimetres of thread from success. A gentle lean towards Wally was all it took, and he at last felt some fresh air between his chinos and the chair. He stood up, gratefully.
Thank you, said Flora.
It's fine. It is for the best. It's partly why I'm changing schools. I've been given leave for the moment. My husband and I currently work at the same school.
Right. Any children involved?
In the school?
Sorry, no. Your husband and you.
No.
I'm divorced, said Wally. I'm sorry to hear that, Flora said.
Clive, who had learnt that a conversation with Wally about his divorce was something to be avoided at all costs, tried to change the subject.
You're here to observe us, are you? He asked.
I have to say, I didn't actually know we were having a new teacher in the department.
No one told you?
No, not your fault, of course, and I'm delighted that we'll have the extra support. Well, not support, actual manpower. Not manpower, obviously, another set of hands, more boots on the ground, another member of staff, that's all I mean.
I know what you mean, said Flora kindly. Thanks. Too tired to bloody think properly. I need a holiday. This term seems to have gone on forever, and we're not quite halfway through it yet.
It'll be much easier with you around, unless someone's leaving. Is someone leaving?
No, I don't think so. Apparently history's becoming so popular at A-level that they've had to expand the department.
Right, well, that's a relief. Thought I might be getting the sack without being told.
They haven't told you?
Clive found himself genuinely laughing. Wally suddenly sighed with despair.
Oh, God, he said. I've got the ruddy lower sixth in 5 minutes. Where does morning break disappear to? I've not even managed to have a coffee. Right, better get my armour on. Nice to meet you, Miss Flora.
Clive and Flora watched Wally sadly walk away.
He seems nice, said Flora.
He's fine, said Clive. He's just absolutely terrified of teaching.
What's Wally short for? What's he short for?
His name. Is it Walter? It's
quite old-fashioned.
He's called Duncan. It's just that the students started calling him Wally, and it sort of caught on.
Chapter 2.
This Sunday?
Yes.
Will it take all day?
Just the afternoon. I thought that maybe you and the girls might like to come along and watch.
Helen snorted. She had been even less thrilled about Clive giving up his one day off than he was, and was unimpressed by his impassioned defence that he'd been forced into it. Clive chewed his supper and tried another tack.
Works well, cold, doesn't it? Glam, with the ratatouille.
Helen poured them each a second glass of wine and then sat down again. They'd stopped eating at the same time as their daughters a few weeks ago. Clive came home from school after 7 o'clock most nights, and Sarah and Katie were ravenous by 5. Besides, Helen felt, this meant that she and her husband were more likely to spend some time alone together each day.
You did go up and see the girls when you got in, didn't you?
Helen asked.
Of course, they're reading, said they'd turn their own lights out.
I'll go up in a bit, make sure they have. You can tell them that you're not going to be around on Sunday, though.
Look, I'm sorry, one more week after Sunday, and then it's half term.
For which we have no plans.
I'll think of something. I said I would. Wouldn't you all like to come down to the match for a bit?
I was planning a picnic. The gardens are open at Tellingthorpe. The Frasers usually put in an appearance.
Frasers?
The Frasers own the house, Clive.
And do we know them?
Well, no, but it would be nice to. We might all get on. I hardly think a pair of aristocrats will have any interest in some teacher and a part-time. Frampton's a very prestigious school, Clive. Don't do yourself down.
Right, why don't you have the picnic at the match?
We could do, but only so the girls actually get to see you, so that I can.
Clive took a sip of his wine and swallowed another forkful of ratatouille. The coldness of the lamb only served to underline just how hot the ratatouille was.
I didn't want to play, Helen. I've been pressured into it, honestly.
Helen looked at her husband and tried to work out how he'd let himself get into this position.
Did he secretly want to play?
Is playing for the staff cricket team the sort of thing that might earn you a promotion? She asked.
No.
Then why on earth are you doing it?
I told bloody Dixon that I could possibly play, and then he told the head that I was definitely playing, and then the head told everyone in the morning break.
I think you'd really like Tellingthorpe.
I'm not sure that if I have one day off, I necessarily want to spend it haring around the gardens of a country house in the hope of meeting some aristocrats who may or may not like us.
Clive, don't be ridiculous. We'd be going there to spend some time together. For you to spend time with the girls, it's about doing things as a family. We like spending time with you.
I see. And if we happen to bump into the Frasers, that would be just a little bonus. You should feign an injury. And then turn up at the school with a limp on Monday.
Helen smiled at him.
Yes, or I'll put your arm in a sling, if you like. The council have sent me on endless first aid courses, I'm sure I could. Clive still looked depressed, so Helen said, Maybe it's good for you to show a bit of willing. It's not being willing, it's basically conscription. The headmaster knows you'd be doing it, so that's good. I've told you before, he undervalues you. I'd like that to change. I'm sure you would, too. He spoke to me today as if I was some sort of competition winner. What does he know? He doesn't even know how to dress like a headmaster. Looks like a hedge fund manager. I'm not bothered about how he dresses. These things are important, Clive. I'm bothered about how he treats people, and... Here, Clive suddenly became so animated that he had to put his fork and glass down so that he could really point and gesticulate. And they've just appointed a new history teacher without even telling me. I didn't even know they'd advertised a position. Why? Who's leaving? No one, apparently. The department's just growing. Don't you think they should have told people? Did they tell the others? Frobisher didn't know anything about it. Roger said he thought he remembered it being discussed as a possibility. So it's not personal, then. I do like that you all refer to each other by your surnames. Clive thought about this. We do, I suppose. It's just habit now. As if we're all suspended in time. But then the entire private education system is suspended in time. We didn't used to do that at Uxbridge. It always amazed Helen how nostalgic Clive was about Uxbridge. He'd been so stressed there that she'd worried about him constantly. The problems there had seemed so much greater than those at Frampton. Anyway, said Clive, how was your day? How are the offices of Frampton Council? Presumably the whole building shakes with the relentless march of progress. Helen smiled at this. Well, we've just got a defibrillator, and we call each other by our first names. And even more excitingly, we're not expected to turn up to things on a Sunday. They should give you a night off in lieu. Couldn't someone else wander around the boarding house making sure that people are doing homework? We call it prep. It doesn't matter what it's called. Couldn't someone lesser be supervising? There's an enormous discrepancy between the regard in which you think I should be held and the regard in which I am actually held. Well, there shouldn't be. And there won't be. I'll see to it.
How?
I just will. Perhaps I'll corner a few people at this match, lay on some charm. You don't need to launch an offensive, but do come. It'll be nice weather, and it'll be a chance to catch up with some of the teachers that you've not seen for a while. It'll be a chance to have Ian Dixon smiling at my chest. Helen knew that she was right. Not just about Ian Dixon's barely concealed lust for all women, but about the school, too. Clive should have been held in high regard by them. She saw how hard they made him work. And she knew that he felt compromised simply by working there in the first place. Despite having been privately educated himself, he and all his contemporaries at teacher training had pledged allegiance to the comprehensive system. Then they all qualified, and many of them immediately found that their ideals collided with reality. One by one, they started dropping out of state schools and applying for cosier jobs at schools with large grounds and libraries and cricket pitches and smaller class sizes. Teaching the entitled just seemed easier than teaching the disillusioned and the uninterested. It was a source of great pride to Helen that Clive had been the last to succumb. He'd done 6 years at the Uxbridge Comprehensive, but it had felt like 12. All around him, his colleagues had been dropping like flies, stress, depression, anxiety, and they could barely afford to live. They'd already had Sarah. Katie was on the way. Finally, Helen had tried to persuade him that his principles were getting in the way of security, comfort, and strong mental health. She left educational supplements lying open on the kitchen table with various advertisements for teaching positions circled in red pen. Clive eventually took the hint. He started reading about history posts at the sort of schools he really hoped that he'd left behind and would never see again. Ancient establishments in small market towns and green-sounding counties, with pupils in school scarves scurrying to and from lessons to the sound of a striking bell. Teachers in academic wear, buttresses, quads, bicycles with wicker baskets, the sound of clarinets and cellos from upstairs windows. Wouldn't this be a nicer world for the girls to grow up in? Helen asked. For a month, Clive called in sick and drove all over England and Wales for interviews. He drove for miles. He soon realised that he liked being on the road and out of school. When he was behind the wheel of a car, he felt free. He was driving through parts of the country he'd never been to towns he'd never heard of. He was eating in strange pubs, smoking in laybys. It was as if Helen had ordered him to take a sabbatical. He wasn't trying to shout down 40 15-year-olds. He would have been happy just going to job interviews like this forever, he thought. Which was just as well, because the interviews certainly weren't resulting in any job offers. Some schools sent him letters kindly explaining about the unusually high standards of the applicants. Others he never heard from again.
But then suddenly along came a letter from Frampton. At first he hadn't been able to remember which one Frampton even was. They'd all been so similar. Cheshire? Devon? He had had to study the AA map. Wiltshire, that was it. He'd eaten a pub lunch in Hungerford, been kept waiting for 3/4 of an hour, and then the interview only lasted 10 minutes. He'd declined the offer of a tour of the school. He would already have seen it all before. It would probably be fine. They would all have probably been fine. But it was Frampton who actually wanted him. So they turned up in August, with one daughter in the back seat, another in the womb, and a new life to begin. A 300-year-old school in the middle of a small market town. Helen was delirious. Clive, dizzy with change, was happy too. But all that was 8 years ago. In London, Clive had taught history from Monday to Friday, and tough though it had been, that was that. Frampton, though, was a boarding school. There were 800 pupils, all boys. The timetable covered the day from 7 in the morning until 9 o'clock at night. There were lessons on Saturdays. There were clubs and societies. Teachers had to be attached to a boarding house and spend an evening a week on duty. Teachers who were good at sport had to teach sport. Teachers who were bad at sport had to supervise the boys who were bad at sport. Boys needed to be taken on outings. Teachers had to drive minibuses to take boys to sports matches, theatres, concerts. It was all-consuming. But boys needed to be kept busy. Their parents had to be kept happy, and the school needed things to boast about in its magazine. Good A-levels, successful sports sides, garlanded musicians. Helen thought that she'd persuaded Clive to take a peachy job in a rural idyll. But Clive now behaved as if he was stuck in a cross between an academic hothouse and a sausage factory. As Clive had been tasked with more and more pastoral responsibilities, Helen had at first encouraged him. But now it had become increasingly clear to Helen that these additional assignments weren't getting Clive anywhere and only made him miserable. She was always asking why he didn't say no to things when he was asked if he could do them. Sympathy gave way to resentment, and in turn, resentment could give way to anger. She despaired of how Clive always responded to being asked if he could do something as if it was a direct order to do it. "Why can't you be more like Wally?" she once asked him. "Divorced and frightened?" Clive asked. Being more like Wally was exactly what he didn't want. "Wally says no to things," Helen said. This much was true. Wally would be asked if he could do something and reply that he couldn't on grounds of ability or suitability or more often because he needed to get home and let his dogs out. Still, he seemed a strange sort of hero. Clive got up to clear the plates. "I'll do that," said Helen. "You go up and see the girls again." Out in the hallway, the girls' school bags were all packed at the foot of the stairs, ready for the next day. Next to them, Clive's battered leather briefcase looked somehow oafish. He stepped over the bags and went up to the girls' room to find the bedside lights on, but both girls fast asleep in Sarah's bed. Katie snuggled up against her older sister. Katie's nighttime reading book was still open in Sarah's hand. Clive carefully slipped it out, replaced the bookmark, and then put the book on Katie's bedside table. He peeled back Katie's duvet in readiness for transporting her sleeping form. It was harder to peel back Sarah's duvet to get Katie out because Sarah liked to pull it up around her shoulders and trap the edge under her armpit. Despite the peaceful look on her face, her arms were clamped into position, and it was a struggle to prise it from her. But if he left them in the same bed, then they'd both be bound to wake. And if Katie ever woke in the night, it meant that her parents would also be woken by the sound of their bedroom door slowly scraping over the rough carpet. Then Katie would wriggle into the middle of their bed, and that night's sleep would effectively be over. Somehow Clive managed to scoop up Katie and carry her, his knees bent, across to her bed and lay her down. That was always when he felt the weight, not picking them up, but putting them down. Even Katie was almost too heavy to carry far now. He gave her a little kiss on the temple and then looked at her light brown hair splayed out across the pillow. She gave a little grunt. Then he pulled Sarah's duvet back over her and she stirred a little and pulled it back into place under her arm. He kissed her too. Then he turned out both lights, stepped noiselessly from the room, and returned to the kitchen and Helen. "More wine?" he asked her. "I'd better not. Do you want to do anything this evening?" "I want to have a bath." Clive went upstairs, brushed his teeth, and slipped into bed. By the time Helen had come back from her bath, he too was lying asleep with an open book on the pillow next to him. Chapter 3. Clive was out of the front door by 7:15 the next day. The others were yet to stir. He had to be on duty in the refectory by 20 past, but it was only a short walk. He pulled back the front gate and turned left.
A further frustration of living this close to school was that it meant that he was the first to be called upon if someone else was late or hadn't shown up. Last week he'd been called from his supper to do evening duty in the place of someone who had hay fever. When they first arrived, it had seemed an advantage to be so close to work and not to have to thread his way through the Uxbridge morning traffic. Wally lived nowhere near the school, probably a 20-minute drive out of Frampton, in a little village with a pub that did food and plenty of woodland where he could walk his mastiffs. He never had to do refectory duty. The row of Victorian terraced houses Clive walked past were mostly still dark, although a few commuters were walking the other way towards the train station. How early must they have had to get up? They always looked immaculate. Nice suits, light summer overcoats, hair brushed and dried. Clive's was still wet from the shower, the occasional drop landing on his neck as he scurried across the street that divided his block from the one that was taken up by the school. He could see its vast stone frontage now, a high stone wall with battlements and Frampton's name and motto inscribed over the grand archway. A few uniformed boys and the odd teacher soon appeared. There were two boarding houses on the main school site, including the one that Clive was attached to, but a further six were dotted around that end of the town. Breakfast was served from 7:25 until 8:05 precisely, but some pupils, especially the ones from overseas, arrived early, perhaps because they were eager to get away from the often unsympathetic atmosphere of the boarding houses. "Morning, sir."
"Morning."
Clive didn't remember being chirpy when he was 14, but a lot of the boys habitually were. They'd had the best part of the academic year to conquer their homesickness, he supposed. As he turned into the arch, there came a honk from behind. Ian Dixon's ludicrous old Mercedes was also turning in, sending the boys scattering. Ian braked and wound down his window.
"Morning, Clive. Sunday's weather's looking really splendid."
"Are you on duty?" asked Clive. "Have I got my day wrong?"
"I'm just here to get a good parking space. Going to walk into town and have breakfast at a cafe. Great news you're joining us on Sunday."
Ian wound up his window again and drove off into the quad. An hour to himself in a cafe sounded dreamy, thought Clive. And it would be an experience entirely wasted on Ian, who could spend as much of his life being solitary as he pleased. A few children began to run around the quad to the refectory on the other side, but Clive hollered to them,
"Breakfast doesn't start until 7:25, and no running in the quad!"
No running in the quad. What a ridiculous phrase that would have seemed to him 10 years ago, and now here he was barking it at people outside a buttress chapel. He might as well have been bellowing at them to keep off the grass or mind out for the geraniums. As he passed the side door to the chapel, it suddenly swung open to reveal the chaplain standing there, blinking into the light.
"Morning, Mark. You been in there overnight?"
"Yeah, I've been kicked out by my wife. Had to snuggle down in a pile of vestments."
"I see."
Mark Taylor, an achingly relaxed bachelor in his late 40s, was dressed in a white T-shirt and a pair of tracksuit bottoms adorned with the name of his Oxford college down one leg.
"Had to get up early and do some bloody admin," he explained. "Marking, photocopying, all the balls I got into this game to avoid.
You playing in this cricket match?"
"Reluctantly. You?"
"Yes."
"Well, that's a relief."
When he'd first arrived at Frampton, Clive, who generally found all church people sinister, had been suspicious of Mark. He didn't seem to say much in the staff room, and Clive had mistaken his languor for diffidence. One morning break, though, the headmaster had been 5 minutes into a quite unwarranted discourse about the uniqueness of the Frampton character, when Clive had looked up to see the chaplain mouthing the word Christ and rolling his eyes. Clive then stifled a laugh loud enough to catch the headmaster's attention, and when the headmaster started up again, the chaplain began to mime vigorously sawing at his own wrists before snapping straight into a look of benign fascination.
"I've seen a lot of grand, tedious sermonizers in my time, but that man really is the apotheosis of the oeuvre," he told Clive over a drink that night.
"Some people say he means well," said Clive.
"Yes," said Mark uncertainly. "That's what people generally say about people who are completely lacking in self-awareness. Do you need another?"
They'd become regular drinking companions from that day on, and Mark often came round to his and Helen's home. He never mentioned religion unless somebody else brought it up, and though his sexual orientation and history were unclear, he was completely insouciant about Helen's attempts to pair him up with a number of local divorcees. These matchmaking endeavours had included a council administrator who still seemed incredibly raw about her recent marital collapse, and who had drunk so incredibly heavily that Helen had asked Mark to walk her home while the main course was still on the table. Mark had attempted to do so, only for the lady in question to insist that he walked her to the home of her soon-to-be ex-husband, after which Mark returned to the dinner table, announced that if anything was going to happen between the two of them, it was probably still a bit early.
"I'm glad you're playing too," said Clive. "I'm really not looking forward to it." "You'll be fine."
Yes, but you can play a bit. Well, I'm all right, said the man who had once kept wicket for Worcestershire Seconds, but it's been a while. It's the fielding I hate.
We'll get it out of the way quickly, and then there'll be a barbecue or something. You'll have to put up with Ian telling you what to do for an afternoon first, but then we can have some fun.
Helen's not pleased. Mark looked at his watch. You on breakfast duty? He asked.
Yes. Again?
Again, indeed. Well, I'll come and join you in a bit. Just have to go and change into my dog collar. Crouch doesn't like me wandering about like this. Mark jogged off towards his cottage, and Clive carried on around the quad towards the refectory, where a queue of boys had already formed. Clive walked past them, nodding politely in response to a few of the morning sirs that came his way, then headed through the double doors, down a tiled corridor and into the serving area, where some of the kitchen staff were wheeling the last of the racks of trays into place. The brightly lit counters were piled high with eggs and bacon and hash browns, and there were vast mountains of toast that would soon be soggy with the steam that rose from the huge catering warmers on which they were piled. The head of catering popped his head out of a door and flashed Clive his bright butcher's grin.
Morning, Mr. Hapgood.
David.
You again, is it?
Me again, I'm afraid. You all ready?
It's a bit early, but yeah, we're good and ready. You can go and let the animals in.
Thanks, David.
Clive walked back down the corridor and held open one of the double doors to let the boys in, then nipped back down to the service area to get to the coffee machine. Unfortunately, a tall boy with black hair and a pockmarked neck had got there first, and Clive waited in line behind him as the machine whirred and puffed before eventually dispensing the boy's drink. But when it had done so, the boy simply put the cup on a tray next to him and then placed another empty cup under the machine. When this drink had been delivered, he began the process again.
Excuse me, said Clive, how many drinks are you getting?
The boy turned around.
Oh, sorry, sir.
Clive recognised him now. Davies. Clive had taught him history once, but he'd be doing his A-levels now. The machine dispensed another drink, and Clive saw that Davies already had another empty cup lined up.
How thirsty are you?
I'm getting drinks for my whole table, sir. There are six of us. It's just that there's a queue, said Clive, indicating himself.
Well, that's the point of our system, sir. It's to avoid queuing.
Okay, fine. Carry on. When Davies had departed with his tray of cups, Clive finally had a chance to put his own cup under the machine. There was now a long queue behind him. But once his drink had been forcibly dispensed, he found himself sliding a second cup under the machine and pressing the button for another milky coffee. Sorry, said to the boy behind him. Saves queuing. The red brick refectory building, the gift of a benefactor on the occasion of some centenary or other, which presumably serendipitously coincided with someone's sudden need to register a tax loss, was far too young to blend into its surroundings, and yet already old enough to be no longer fit for purpose. The school had doubled in size since it was built, and thus its capacity was insufficient. There were only 180 tables, and so the times that the inhabitants of different boarding houses could eat had to be staggered. Large queues formed outside and in. Clive often marvelled at how a building with so many windows could possibly have been so dark. He found eating there to be unendurable, not least because once he had food on his tray came the agony of not knowing where to sit. There was a stage at one end with a long table on it, which was intended for staff to dine at, but it was generally only used at lunch or supper, and Clive would have felt silly going up there and sitting down on his own. Sometimes it could be fun to sit down with a few of the boys, but only if invited, which hadn't happened today. Instead, he took up position in a corner with his twin cups of coffee, but they were still too hot and had become a ludicrous impediment. He raised one to his lips and blew on it to try and cool it down, then took a small but nevertheless agonising sip. It was rare that anything happened at breakfast, but it was necessary to be there in case something did. As breakfast wore on, the clamour grew louder and louder, but not to the point where one could have reasonably requested them to be quiet. It was just white noise, the soundtrack to him having to be up an hour early in order to impassively observe nearly 200 upper-middle-class teenagers all eating at once. He decided to get some toast, possibly jettisoning the ridiculous extra cup of coffee on the way, and so began walking back along the side of the stage towards the entrance to the serving area. As he did so, he saw a small boy come wobbling through the entrance, carrying a tray piled far higher than it ought sensibly to have been. Some boys were really unlucky, he thought. Lots of children arrived at the school with their voices already broken and growth spurts well underway. Others, like this one, arrived in an obviously still prepubescent state and stayed that way for much of their first year, sticking out like sore thumbs, partly because of their diminutive statures, their blazers too long at the sleeve, their over-large uniform trousers flapping about at their heels and constantly needing to be pulled up at the waist, but also because of their shrill voices and an innocent gloss to their skin and hair that adolescence had yet to take the sheen off. Clive recognised instantly that here was the sort of boy who attracted rough and unhelpful behaviour like a magnet. Frampton was one of those schools that insisted to its parents that it had no problem with bullying whatsoever, but the only sense in which this was really true was that it was institutionally tolerated. Big people were cruel to small people. Sporty people were cruel to unsporty people. Even people who were only reasonably intelligent could be cruel to dim people. This was generally looked upon by those whose job it should have been to stamp out such behaviour as Darwinism manifest. One of the headmaster's innovations a couple of years ago was to insist that the school developed a bullying policy. "There isn't a problem with bullying," he told his staff, "but it might be worth putting a structure in place so that in the event of any instances of bullying coming to light completely out of the blue, then the school will be in a position to deal effectively with those responsible and sympathetically with those who are the victims. We will be protecting both them and ourselves." Everybody in the staff room that morning break had nodded earnestly and gone back to their coffee. Then 2 days later, the headmaster announced that he had asked Richard Crawford, Dip Ed, Physical Education, to front the Bullying Task Force. Crawford's expertise in this department was mainly as an exponent. He made skinny boys do shuttle runs until they were sick, and he called the overweight boys fatty. Now he had the chance to pull more pupils, and indeed the occasional staff member, to one side and give them a rollicking, to let them know that he was onto them. "How would you like it if someone did that to you, eh?" he'd scream at people, his face inches from theirs, his hand having found its way instinctively to their collar to clutch it in a tight grip. But Richard Crawford, Dip Ed, Physical Education, like all men who appear strong, had a weakness. In his case, he liked stopping girls from the nearby comprehensive in the street and chatting to them. Sometimes they'd go to cafes with him and chat there, about all kinds of things, and sometimes their fathers, who didn't care how big and strong he thought he was, would knock on his front door and quietly ask him just what the fuck he thought was going on. Word got back to the school. "We should hold an internal investigation," the school said. "We should call the police," the father said. "Look," the school reasoned, "the last thing anybody needs in a situation like this is any kind of fuss." Fuss, the father said, would be just the beginning. The threat of police involvement hung over Crawford for just too long.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.